mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical.
The Philippines reports 18,332 new COVID-19 infections, the biggest daily tally yet.
Philippine health officials warn the ongoing spike in COVID-19 cases this August has already exceeded the previous peak in April this year.
Malacanang calls on health workers not to push through with planned mass resignations.
And the Philippine Food and Drug Administration grants emergency use authorization to Russia's single-dose Sputnik Light COVID-19 vaccine.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Kerr.
And I'm Denise Dinsai.
You're watching Top Story. The Philippines logs yet another record high number of new COVID cases. The country confirms 18,332 more infections in the past 24 hours, the highest single-day tally since the pandemic began. This comes just days after the country hit its previous record high of over 17,000 cases. The number of active infections in the country has now climbed to 130,000, the highest since April 19th. Meanwhile, the DOH also confirmed 151 more deaths and 13,000 new recoveries.
The Philippines also reports more cases of the Delta variant. The health department confirmed 466 new cases of the highly transmissible Delta variant, 442 of which are local cases, while 14 are among returning overseas Filipinos. Of the local cases, nearly half live in Metro Manila. There are also dozens more of new Delta variant infections in Central Luzon, Western Visayas, and Calabar Zone. This brings the total number of Delta variant cases in the country to 1,273, including 8 deaths. One case remains active.
Amid increasing number of Delta infections, the Philippine Health Department says community transmission of the Delta variant is already being observed in Metro Manila and the Calabarzon region, but it stressed the need for more evidence before declaring outright there is community transmission. Based on the World Health Organization's definition, community transmission is when large numbers of cases can no longer be linked to transmission chains, or that there are multiple unrelated clusters in several areas of a country.
Dito sa NCR, nakita natin yung biglang pagtaas ng mga kaso at saka pagtaas nung nade-detect natin na Delta variant. So the assumption is there, lahat ng action natin ay geared towards that level of community transmission already. But as to confirming it, kailangan kasi namin ng ebidensya. Currently, we have seen and observed, no, especially in NCR and Region 4A, na talagang mukhang community transmission na ito. Nakita natin na wala nang link ang mga kaso sa bawat isa. We are seeing clustering of cases in these two big regions. Kaya iyan po ay isang bagay na pinagtutuunan natin ng pansin sa ngayon.
The ongoing spike in COVID-19 cases this August has already exceeded the previous peak in April this year. Data from the health department show the number of average daily reported cases in the Philippines was at around 14,300 from August 16 to 22. That's higher than the average of 10,400 cases reported from March 29 to April 4.
It is probable na magkaroon pa tayo ng higher peak. But again, the numbers can change depending on what we will do, no, and what we have been doing.
Meanwhile, the capacity at intensive care units across hospitals in Metro Manila is now under high-risk classification. Health Undersecretary Leopoldo Vega says, of the nearly 1,300 ICU beds in the National Capital Region, 73% are currently occupied.
You have to take a look at the COVID cases that we have. And we're seeing roughly about almost 98% mild, moderate, and asymptomatics. We've seen a numbers of 1.86 for the severe and critical. This is kind of different from what we saw in April and last year, where it was hovering around 3% for the severe and critical. With this 1,245 ICU that we have right now, can cover the 1.86 severe and critical patients that we have. But of course, if the numbers will still go up, then we will have to find out and sort out and align our hospital beds for this COVID patient.
Roughly 70% of active COVID-19 cases in the National Capital Region are unvaccinated individuals. Metropolitan Manila Development Authority Chairman Benhur Abalos says the unvaccinated make up more than 15,000 of the 21,000 active infections in the NCR.
Look at the death, look at the critical, and look at the severe. These data speak for themselves that really it's very important to get vaccinated.
Meanwhile, Abalos says 78% of senior citizens in the NCR have already been fully vaccinated. 41% of individuals with comorbidities have also received their second dose.
Some business leaders in the Philippines expressed disappointment over how the government implemented the enhanced community quarantine in Metro Manila. Some are saying while the shift to modified ECQ is a welcome development, Philippine officials failed to maximize the two-week hard lockdown. They point out the health system did not improve. Others, meanwhile, are questioning the government's use of lockdowns.
Sinulat din namin last year pa na huwag pabayaan na hindi na yung mga hospital kailangan tuloy-tuloy ang pagdagdag ng kwarto dahil pag nagkaroon ng surge. Huwag din pabayaan na yung mga frontliners natin hindi maalagaan. Nangyari?
Tayo, nakailan lockdown tayo, ang ating sistema pare-pareho at hindi nakikita natututo. Ang nilarason lang, napupuno ang mga hospital. Yung mga facilities, kumukulang.
Is it enough to lock down the economy? I know we have to follow protocols and procedures, but maybe I may be wrong, we are approaching a health issue with militaristic solutions.
An association of restaurant owners and employees in the Philippines backing proposals to allow fully vaccinated individuals to dine out. The president of RestoPH, Eric Tang, says government should consider safely reopening the economy. He notes other countries like France and Canada have allowed limited dine-in operations at restaurants for inoculated individuals.
This is not something that we see as discriminatory, which is we want to make clear is that we want to entertain as many customers as possible, vaccinated or unvaccinated. Mm-hmm. We are not of the mindset that we will shut our doors to the unvaccinated. What we're asking is to ask for more mobility for the vaccinated.
Presidential Advisor for Entrepreneurship Joy Concepcion also suggesting that the government limit the mobility of unvaccinated individuals. Cabinet Secretary Carlo Nograles says the COVID task force will look into this, as well as the creation of transport bubbles for the vaccinated.
Nasa 42% na kasi, and that was in the last IATF meeting. So we have a few days more to go until end of August. So we're very confident that we'll hit the 45%. Yung sa senior citizens natin, when IATF said na yung mga senior citizens na fully vaccinated can already go out, nagkaroon ng increase doon sa mga senior citizens who will want to get vaccinated.
Intercity travel still not allowed in Metro Manila despite the shift to a looser quarantine classification. Police say only authorized people working in other cities or municipalities or those with medical emergencies will be allowed to pass through the borders.
Pagbabasihan natin itong mga guidance ito para ipatupad dyan sa aming pagbabantay sa mga checkpoint sa iba't ibang lugar kung saan pupunta ating mga kabayan. At siguraduhin na kung sila ay allowed lumabas, they observing the minimum public health standard.
Several Metro Manila cities have opened their COVID vaccination drives to non-residents. These cities include San Juan, Pateros, Mandaluyong, and Marikina, which are nearly done vaccinating its residents. Those from nearby provinces of Cavite, Laguna, Bulacan, and Rizal can register online to schedule their vaccination.
Kami sa Mandaluyong, halos 90% na ho kami, nagmamapping up na lang kami. Pateros, tapos na rin po. Nag-usap kami, pati San Juan is tapos na rin po. Inopen na po namin sa mga hindi tiga lugar namin. Inopen na namin, hindi lamang tiga NCR, pati sa neighbors namin.
The Philippines has so far administered more than 30 million COVID-19 vaccine doses since the rollout began in March. More than 13 million Filipinos have been fully vaccinated. Still a long way to go from government's goal of at least 50 million by year end. Vaccine Chief Carlito Galvez Jr. says the government expects to receive around 5 million doses this week.
The Philippine Food and Drug Administration grants emergency use authorization to Russia's single-dose Sputnik Light COVID-19 vaccine. That's according to Vaccine Chief Carlito Galvez Jr. Sputnik Light demonstrated 79.4% efficacy compared to 91.6% for the two-shot Sputnik V. Galvez says government will try to secure millions of Sputnik Light doses.
We will follow up more or less 10 million natin na doses. It will become tiyatawag natin 10 million treatments, meaning 10 million na tao ang makikinabang nito ng full protection, considering that yung Sputnik Light is one dose na siya.
Sputnik Light is the 9th COVID vaccine approved for emergency use here in the Philippines.
The city of Tigigaraw in Cagayan to remain under the strictest lockdown classification for another week. That's as COVID-19 cases there continue to surge. Tigigaraw had already been placed under a 10-day enhanced community quarantine. Active cases in the city spiked by more than 500 during that period. Amid rising infections, the Cagayan Valley Medical Center in Tuguegarao is already nearing full capacity. Meanwhile, the office of the Vice President is also getting overwhelmed by the number of calls it's getting for its teleconsultation program. The OVP says inquiries went up from 100 calls a day to 400.
Si BP mismo, Kaeli, lagi yung nag-graveyard shift. Simula alas 11 or midnight, nakatutok na po yan sa emergency thread namin, tsaka sa LGU referral thread, para kung meron talagang emergency na mangyari, kailangan i-facilitate agad sa hospital or itawag sa local government unit para rumisponde at makatugon dun sa pangangailangan ng pamilya or pasyente.
House lawmakers are looking to help resolve the issue between state insurer PhilHealth and private hospitals that's threatening to further cripple the country's healthcare system. Over the weekend, private hospital and doctors groups threatened to disengage from the state insurer. That's following a circular temporarily suspending payments to healthcare providers with questionable claims. Hospitals and doctors say the move is just a ploy to further delay pending payments to health facilities amounting to around 86 billion pesos. The House Committee on Health is set to hold a dialogue with the two sides Tuesday to discuss the matter. Committee Chair Quezon Representative Helen Tan hopes to resolve the issue immediately as the country battles a COVID surge. Senator Bongo, the chairman of the Senate Health Committee, also calling for reconciliation between the two parties.
PhilHealth defends the issuance of the circular in question. PhilHealth spokesperson Dr. Shirley Domingo says the temporary suspension of claims is a policy being implemented since 2016. This, according to her, is actually beneficial to hospitals because it protects them against arbitrary investigation. She also clarified the state insurer only owes hospitals nearly 13 billion pesos and not 86 billion pesos. Dr. Domingo is also confident the issue will soon be resolved and will not lead to hospitals disengaging from PhilHealth.
There's no impasse at the moment. That's my message to all our members. There's no impasse. We're talking with the hospitals. We're currently in a meeting with them now. And we will not let that reach to that extent wherein they disengage. Because at the end, it will be the Filipino people who will suffer if they disengage. Because if they do that, then it will be up to the Filipinos or the people to pay for themselves. And that's not equitable because those who doesn't have money will not be able to pay for their hospitalization. That's the reason we have a social health insurance scheme. If there's any mismanagement or any issues about that, then we talk about it. But let's not go back to an unequitable a way of paying our health services.
The Private Hospitals Association of the Philippines, meanwhile, asserts membership in PhilHealth among private hospitals is completely voluntary. The group's president, Dr. Jose Rene de Grano, says hospitals have been carrying a double burden with PhilHealth's debt coupled with the pandemic.
For the past 2 years, we've been trying to recover our losses from PhilHealth. And a lot, maybe at least two of our hospital members have stopped operations because they were not paid. And then, of course, a lot of our hospitals have downsized. What happens to the hospital? They will keep on, of course, we will keep on admitting our patients, but we will not be paid. How can we continue our operations if we continue to spend for our patients, for the benefits of the PhilHealth members, and then nobody will be paying us? How can we give the payments to our healthcare workers? At the same time, how can we give better service to our PhilHealth members?
De Grano adds the group is still in talks with member hospitals about disengaging from PhilHealth.
I think a lot of our members are already having the thought that they are already pushed against the wall and they have no other way but to disengage. That's the problem right now. And of course, this is not immediate. We are still asking our members what they plan to do. The thing is, they are given until probably end of the year to think whether to engage to renew.
Malacañang appeals to health workers not to push through with a plan to conduct mass resignations. Several health workers' groups have threatened resignations or work stoppage over their unreleased benefits. But the palace points out President Duterte has already given the health and budget departments a deadline to settle the benefits.
Nag-order naman po ang Presidente na within 10 days from last, when was that? Last Friday, kinakailangan mabigay na ito mga special risk allowance. At kapag nag-resign po sila, dadami yung hanay na walang trabaho sa panahon ng pandemya, mas lalala po ang problema natin kung mas maraming walang trabaho sa panahon ng pandemya at wala naman po tayong karagdagang ayuda na maibibigay.
The Philippine Health Department is using 311 million pesos from its savings to pay for the special risk allowance of over 20,000 health workers. Health Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergeris says the funds will cover both public and private health workers. But she adds they are still waiting for the final list that will be submitted by regional offices so that they can come up with a final number. Between September 2020 and June 2021, the DOH has already disbursed 10.3 billion pesos for the special risk allowance of 685,000 medical workers. But many of them have aired their grievances about not receiving the allowance. Up ahead, a growing COVID-19 outbreak in New Zealand forces the extension of a national lockdown.
And Taiwan rolls out its first domestically developed COVID vaccine despite objections. More news when we return.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Welcome back. You're still watching Top Story. A Catholic charitable institution in Manila again calling for help amid the raging COVID-19 pandemic. Let's now talk to Sister Maria Socorro Pilar Evidente, administrator of the Hospicio de San Jose. Sister, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Denise.
How is the good afternoon, Sister? But how is the current situation there in Hospicio de San Jose?
Well, at the moment, the statistics of our COVID positive patients is 103.
So 103 patients. How about for the personnel?
Actually, out of the 103, we have 49 children, mm-hmm. 21 elderly, and the rest are personnel.
And how have you been surviving, the institution rather, throughout this whole year of pandemic?
Well, we have very faithful donors who support us when we need their help. They are just a text away sometimes or an email away. But now, with this pandemic, four already are in the hospital. We had to rush somebody else this afternoon, two elderly, and then two of our personnel are in the hospital. But the rest are quite faring okay, and they're recovering.
Where did they get the COVID, Sister, if you have any knowledge of it?
Actually, we have three possibilities. Mm-hmm. First is, for the whole month of July, we were supposed to be already free of COVID because we had COVID last April to June, and towards the end of June, wala na kami COVID, but starting July and August, there was high tide almost every day, not counting the storms, the rains that came in July. And so we get flooded. And so in July, the first things I asked for donations was boots for everybody so that they would not be contaminated by yung urine ng daga, no? So I was able to get donations for boots for everybody.
Yes.
But of course, the residue that remains in our premises after the tide goes down, even though how much we do pressure washing and sanitation, we really don't know if there are bacteria or virus coming from the river And you know, a river is connected to Manila Bay. Mm-hmm. So ganun ba? That's one suspect of ours. The second is, towards the beginning of July, some of our children had to go back and see their doctors because they had been locked down for so long. Even our personnel, they were asking to go to see their doctors. And so I cannot refuse them because it's been months, years that they've been locked down here. So with all the health protocols and instructions given them, I just don't know if nakalusot ang virus because of that, because yes, many of those who went to the hospital are positive.
Now with the COVID, yes, sister, sorry, and continue.
And then the third reason maybe can be the food. Our personnel are ordering food online. They like to eat good food from outside. Mm-hmm. So when somebody started to have fever and we tested positive, I really prohibited them from ordering outside. So we had to provide meals for everybody, 3 meals for everybody. All the employees are locked down here with their dependents. We feed them so that they will not have to buy food outside anymore.
Of the 103 of the people staying, of course, in the institution, has one of them reported or has the case of the Delta variant?
Di namin alam kasi sa Senica Laboratory po kami nagpapaswab test. They are just too good to us na free ang swab test namin. Every time we need to have a swab test, Dr. Senica really avails his swabbers for us. So hindi pa kami nakatanong sa kanila kung sa analysis pa nila may Delta variant doon sa mga nag-test ng positive.
Okay. Sister, we all know that with the rise of the COVID-19 pandemic, pati na rin ho yung financial crisis. Kanina ho, sinabi niyo na dati yung mga donors, isang text lang. Did you see a decrease, of course, of donors, you know, donating and also sponsorship for the Hospicio de San Jose?
Yeah, we still, because of these hospital bills that we have to pay, mabuti nga, since this morning when I appealed in public, tinanggap na ng Manila Emergency Mayok ang aming pasyente. But the three others are in San Juan de Dios. Mm-hmm. So we pay the bills for their hospitalization and it goes up every day. So we really don't know. We are trying to keep everybody well. But we don't know. Maybe tonight somebody will be rushed to the hospital again. Mm-hmm. I really don't know. Because every night that's our suffering. Yes. Before we go to sleep at night, somebody has to be rushed to the hospital. Mm-hmm. So,
you know, what help is...
Yeah, we need more assistance.
Yeah, sister, what help is specifically needed for the institution? Is it financial? Is it more beds? How's the space? Food?
Well, from the government, I really appeal that they will really accommodate our elderly and our patients to their quarantine facilities so that we don't have to rush them to hospitals where we have to pay the bills. And of course, another thing is because of the feeding that we have to do every day, we really need financial assistance for that. But at the same time, there are some organizations of people who would prefer to give goods. So ang sinasabi na lang namin, yung pwede na maluto kaagad, yung vegetables, fruits, cold cuts or anything that that can be cooked immediately and can be used for feeding, so we lessen our marketing expenses.
So aside from the government, sister, how can private organizations or even private citizens offer their help for the institution? Who do they contact?
Actually, yeah, they can contact me. My number is 0908-865-0251, or another number is 0919-2199-881. And I advise them, our donors, to email their deposit slips so that our accounting office can immediately identify their donations in our bank books. So my email is MSPG, that is for Maria Socorro Pilargarin, .evidente@gmail.com.
Okay.
Sister, so they can contact me. I'm trying to catch up with with the donors now. They're starting to clump up again my email, but it's okay. I would like to grasp this opportunity also to thank everybody who are helping us. Believe talaga ako, kaagad-agad, after I made my appeal yesterday through GMA, people are coming in with their donations. So I really appreciate their warm support. It is a source of strength for us in our trying moments.
Okay, thank you, Sister Maria Socorro Pilar Evidente, Administrator of the Hospicio de San Jose. Sister, thank you so much. Please take care.
Thank you, Denise. Thank you, Denise. God bless you.
Overseas, the Delta variant outbreak in New Zealand grows. The country reported 35 new cases Monday, taking the total number of infections at its current outbreak to 107. 33 of those cases were recorded in Auckland, while the remaining two were in Wellington. The rise in cases forced Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern to extend New Zealand's national lockdown until Friday, except for Auckland, which will be under lockdown until the end of the month. Ardern also suspended Parliament for a week, warning the current outbreak has not peaked yet.
Taiwan begins administering its first domestically developed COVID-19 vaccine. And first to get the shot, Taiwanese President Tsai Ing-wen, in a bid to demonstrate the vaccine's safety. Amid objections, the approval process was rushed. Taipei approved the emergency use of Medigen's COVID-19 shot last month as part of a broader plan for vaccine self-sufficiency in light of delays in deliveries from global drug firms. More than 700,000 people have so far signed up to receive the Medigen vaccine. The shot was developed in collaboration with the National Institutes of Health in the U.S.
Turning now to the crisis in Afghanistan, Germany says a firefight broke out between unidentified gunmen, Western security forces and Afghan guards at the Kabul airport. U.S. and German forces were said to have been involved in that incident, which reportedly left at least one Afghan guard dead and three others injured. The Kabul airport has been a scene of chaos as thousands of Afghans and foreigners continue to try to flee the Taliban's rule. On Sunday, Taliban fighters beat back crowds at the airport, a day after seven Afghans were killed in a crush at the gates.
U.S. President Joe Biden says Washington has an unwavering commitment to get American citizens and at-risk Afghans out of the war-torn country. Biden admits the situation in Afghanistan is changing rapidly, but he assures the international community the U.S. is working with more than two dozen countries to secure agreements for Afghan refugees.
Let me be clear. The evacuation of thousands of people from Kabul is going to be hard and painful, no matter when it started, when we began. It would have been true if we had started a month ago or a month from now. There is no way to evacuate this many people without pain and loss of heartbreaking images you see on television. It's just a fact. My heart aches for those people you see. We are proving that we can move those thousands of people a day out of Kabul. We're bringing our citizens, NATO allies, Afghanis who helped us in the war effort. But we have a long way to go, and a lot could still go wrong. But to move out 30,000 people in just over a week, that's a great testament to the men and women on the ground in Kabul and our armed services.
Biden also said his administration may extend his August 31 deadline for removing all American troops from Afghanistan.
And I want to say again just how difficult this mission is and how dangerous it poses to our troops on the ground. There are civilians crowded at the airport, although we've cleared thousands of them. We know that terrorists may seek to exploit the situation and target innocent Afghans or American troops. Our hope is we will not have to extend, but there are going to be discussions, I suspect, on how far along we are in the process.
Australia willing to assist with the evacuations from Afghanistan after August 31st should the U.S. decide to delay its withdrawal. Australia has evacuated about 1,000 citizens and Afghans from Kabul in the past week. It says it is willing to support more rescue flights out of Kabul. Australia has also offered 3,000 visas to Afghans escaping the Taliban's rule.
Over 450 people we've been able to evacuate overnight. That brings to over 1,000 people, together with the United Kingdom, we've been able to evacuate over the course of these operations. And I want to note that that includes not only Australians, but it includes a large number of Afghan locally engaged employees and humanitarian visa holders that we've been able to get out of the country. In addition to that, there are many women and children that we've been able to get out of Afghanistan in what has been some of the most extreme conditions our people have ever operated in, if not worse.
An Afghan woman gave birth to a baby girl on board an evacuation plane. More in this report.
This photo was taken moments after an Afghan woman gave birth to a baby girl on a U.S. evacuation aircraft on Saturday. According to a tweet by the U.S. Air Mobility Command, the mother went into labor and began having complications on board. And the aircraft commander decided to descend in altitude to increase air pressure in the aircraft, which helped stabilize and save the mother's life. The U.S. Air Force also posted photos of medical personnel rushing to help the mother and baby on the tarmac at the Ramstein Air Base in Germany. It added the mother and baby were, quote, in good condition. They were transported to a medical facility. The woman was part of a group fleeing the Taliban in Afghanistan and was on the second stage of an evacuation flight that had taken off from a base in the Middle East. Thousands of desperate people gather at Kabul airport every day in the hope of fleeing Afghanistan's new Taliban rulers. According to a NATO official, at least 20 people have died in the past 7 days in and around the airport.
Philippine shares set out an Asia-wide rally after suffering a last-minute drop. Michelle Ong reports.
Most Asian shares managed a fragile bounce on Monday amid a wave of bargain hunting. But not Philippine shares. For the day, the PSE index edged lower, losing more than 0.5% to close below 6,600 level. Regina Capital's Luis Limlingan says key resistance levels seem to be at the 6,700 and 7,000 mark.
Our strategy for this year is to keep everything very short term. So if you made a good return or you're happy with it, I think it's advisable to keep it in cash.
For this week, there are no major economic data expected for the Philippines. Globally, investors will keep an eye on the annual Jackson Hole Symposium for clues on the taper plans from the Federal Reserve. As for Banco Central Governor Ben Jokno, the Philippine Central Bank is in no rush to make drastic policy changes.
So there will be no drastic change in the current monetary policy. We will continue to be patient and supportive of the efforts to sustain the recovery process. We have turned the corner, as I said before, but it is still fragile.
In corporate stories, DMCI Power Corporation is investing 3.5 billion pesos to expand its generation capacity in the off-grid market to 164 megawatts from 136. In the pipeline, a 2.7 billion peso thermal power plant in Palawan and an 800 million peso hybrid diesel solar power plant in Masbate. Meanwhile, AC Energy, the newest member of the PSE Index, set to complete the sale of Power Barge assets by the fourth quarter. ASEN is selling Power Barge 101 and the non-operational 102 and 103. Finally, RL Commercial REIT of the Gokongwei Group sets the final offer price of its upcoming IPO at 6 pesos 45 centavos per share. Now that's about 12% lower than the price indicated in its initial prospectus. With the up to 23.5 billion peso IPO, RCR is touted to be the largest REIT in the country based on market cap, portfolio valuation, and asset size. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
The proposed 5 trillion peso budget plan for next year, now up for Congress's scrutiny. The spending plan has been submitted to Congress and is expected to face tougher review. That's following the release of the Commission and Audit's reports detailing government's alleged misuse of pandemic response funds. The social services sector will receive the biggest chunk of next year's budget at over 1.9 trillion pesos. It will fund education-related programs and medical services like the Universal Health Program and the purchase of COVID-19 vaccines. Other sectors with bigger slices of the proposed budget include economic services, general public services, debt burden, and defense.
The Philippine Central Bank reviewing two more digital bank applications before closing the window for submissions of new applications by the end of the month. Central Bank Governor Benjamin Diokno says the BSP has granted five digital banking licenses, two of which were conversions from the previous banking category. Diokno says the pause in accepting new applications will help the central bank review the new banking category.
So we need the 3 years to look at the look at digital banking, see whether there's a need for more or there's a need to limit. And so also gives us time to monitor carefully the contribution of digital banking to the Philippine economy.
Oil prices here in the Philippines are set for another rollback. Starting tomorrow, August 24, gasoline prices will go down by 80 centavos per liter. Diesel prices will be lower by 75 centavos a liter. Meanwhile, a liter of kerosene will be 90 centavos cheaper. Industry players say the continued decline in oil prices is due to falling demand as more countries enter renewed lockdowns to control the spread of the Delta variant.
Over in Lebanon, gas prices rise by 66%, a huge hike that aims to ease crippling shortage, but will mean more hardship for Lebanese. This report.
The Lebanese government is raising gasoline prices by two-thirds as it tries to ease crippling fuel shortages that have brought the country to a standstill. But Sunday's step will mean yet more hardship for Lebanese, more than half of whom have been pushed into poverty over the past couple of years by a financial meltdown, which has wiped more than 90% off the value of the Lebanese pound. Lebanon's fuel crisis has brought basic services to their knees, and queuing for hours at gas stations in a daily scramble for fuel has become part of life. Hospitals, bakeries and many businesses are also scaling back or shutting down as fuel runs dry. The crisis worsened this month when the central bank said it could no longer finance fuel imports at heavily subsidized rates and would switch to market exchange rates instead. Price increases will take effect immediately, the government said in a statement. The rise does not fully lift the exchange rate for pricing fuel to the rate at which the central bank will finance its imports. So the state will have to fund the gap for now. Lebanon's Hezbollah, which is backed by Tehran, has arranged for a shipment of fuel from Iran to help ease the shortage in Lebanon.
More to come, Israel launches a probe into a deadly stampede last April. Stay with us.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth. We'll be right back.
Welcome back. Israel launches a probe into a deadly stampede last April that ended up becoming its worst civilian disaster. Here's the full story.
A state inquiry into a stampede at a Jewish pilgrimage site that killed 45 people in April began hearing witnesses on Sunday to find out what led to Israel's worst civilian disaster. Tens of thousands of ultra-Orthodox Jews thronged the Galilee hillside tomb of a second century sage for the annual Lag BaOmer festival that includes all-night prayer, mystical songs and dance. During the ceremony, part of the crowd surged into a narrow tunnel and 45 men and boys were asphyxiated or trampled. US and Canadian citizens were among the dead. Israel's government watchdog years ago deemed the Mount Meron site hazardous. Although the number of worshippers was lower than usual, it still exceeded that permitted at the time by COVID-19 curbs. Some Israelis had questioned whether the former government under Benjamin Netanyahu and police were reluctant to further limit the crowd size because of pressure from influential ultra-Orthodox leaders. Launched shortly after a new government was sworn in, the State Commission of Inquiry has the power to summon witnesses and require them to produce any evidence it deems relevant. Its findings will be presented to the government, though they are not legally binding.
Over in the U.S., Tennessee begins recovery efforts from the devastation caused by heavy rains and widespread flooding. At least 21 people died and some 50 others remain missing after record rainfall hit parts of the state over the weekend. The bad weather also destroyed hundreds of homes and triggered massive power outages.
The difference, of course, for this particular flood is the record level of flooding. I think we received about 15 inches of rain in a 12-hour period of time. Not sure about that particular number, but close to that. It's very different than flooding we've had before, but I'm sure there will be assessments after the fact. What happened, how it happened, are there ways that we can look to mitigate this going forward? But right now we know this is a result of a record flood like that community has not seen before with regard to the amount of rainfall.
U.S. President Joe Biden vows support for the state following the tragedy.
I want to begin by expressing my deepest condolences for the sudden and tragic loss of life due to this flash flood. I know we've reached out to the community and we stand ready to offer them support. I've asked the administrator to speak to Governor Lee of Tennessee right away and will offer any assistance they need for this terrible moment.
Let's now check on the weather here in the Philippines with Pagasa forecaster Ariel Rojas. Ariel?
Hi, good afternoon, Denise. Tropical storm Omais, formerly Isang, continues to move away from the country and towards South Korea and will not have any influence on the weather here anymore. Apart from Omais, we are not monitoring any other weather disturbance that may form within or enter the Philippine area of responsibility in the next 2 to 3 days. Southwest monsoon or Habagat is currently affecting the western sections of southern Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao and will bring rainy weather over occidental Mindoro and Palawan tonight and tomorrow, and residents of these areas should watch out for possible flash floods and landslides during moderate to heavy rains. Isolated thunderstorms may be experienced tonight over Metro Manila and the rest of the country, and Pagasa's regional office says issue thunderstorm advisories and post them on our official social media accounts. Tomorrow, these areas will have warm and humid conditions, while thunderstorm will still be possible in the afternoon and in the evening. Fisher folks and those with small sea craft can safely venture out to sea as we are not expecting big waves over our seaboards. And as latest from Pagasa, this is Ariel Rojas. Good afternoon.
Thanks, Ariel.
In entertainment now, Hugh Jackman is back in an all-action thriller. Manny the Movie Guy reviews Reminiscence along with the other fresh releases from Hollywood.
We have time for one more job.
In this derivative sci-fi thriller, Hugh Jackman is a private investigator of the mind. He lets people relive their memories until the past comes back to haunt him. Sounds intriguing, but this hodgepodge of Blade Runner meets Vertigo by way of Inception is forgettable. The art design and cinematography are good, but even those are copies of better films. Reminiscence gets 2 out of 4. Forget about it. Kisses.
How is this possible?
A slightly better film that mixes sci-fi and horror is Demonic, from writer-director Neil Blomkamp, who gave us District 9. This has Carly Pope finding the truth about her comatose mother, using a new technology that turns you into a 3D version of yourself inside a three-dimensional universe.
Connecting to technology.
Scary with a problematic final act, Demonic gets 2.5 out of 4 in theaters and on demand. Kisses. Also in theaters and on demand, Habit. This film was met with controversy when it was announced that Paris Jackson was going to play Jesus Christ. She did, but watch it first. There's a logical reason behind it.
Working at the club?
Bella Thorne is a religious party girl embroiled in a messed up drug deal, so she and her two BFFs hide out by dressing up as nuns. Rockstar Gavin Rossdale shows up as a prophetic drug dealer.
It seems to be quite a modern take on a relationship with Jesus.
You don't have to say Hail Marys to enjoy this film. Just lower your expectations and you'll have fun with this all-female God squad. Habit gets 2.5 out of 4 kisses as well. And another woman who can kick major booty, Maggie Q in The Protégé. She's the protege of the title under the care of Samuel L. Jackson, but not for long if Michael Keaton can have his way.
It's very, very well done.
Stylish and fast-paced with just enough character development to get you going, The Protégé gets 2.5 out of 4 kisses. And finally, for the entire family, we have Paw Patrol, the movie.
Actually, sir, I'm a puppy.
Based on the TV series Paw Patrol, this smart and cuddly big screen version is good for both the young and the old. Kids will love the colorful animation and the action scenes featuring their favorite pups, while grown-ups will be charmed by its good old-fashioned sensibilities. Take your family and enjoy Paw Patrol the movie. It gets 3 out of 4. Arf, arf, arf. Kisses. I'm Manny the Movie Guy for ANC.
And before we go, catch After the Fact with award-winning journalist Christian Esguera at 8 p.m. here on ANC. Tonight's episode will tackle fighting Senator Manny Pacquiao's career following his loss to Yordanis Ugas in Las Vegas. After the Fact will air right after TV Patrol and Before the World Tonight. And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Dinsai.
And I'm Ron Cruz. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thanks for watching.